I think it would be me with a television showing Downton Abbey on repeat, all episodes.
So, Nik Kershaw, tour's coming up in October. I just wanted to go back to when did you start playing around with the idea of that?
Well, I guess I've seen some of my peers who might have, had hits in 82 and 83 and stuff like that. They've been doing their own 40th anniversary things in the last couple of years. So I saw it looming.
Right. I was going to say, was it on your mind?
Yeah, because 1984, it was, if I'm going to celebrate any year, it's going to be 1984, because it was clearly my biggest year, with the two albums. So yeah, it just seemed like a good idea, really. It seemed like, it seems like it'd be rude not to.
Yeah, I was going to ask. I mean, why did you why that? I mean, you've talked about being your biggest albums. Why that and not a 40-year kind of career spanning set, or is that in the pipeline? Is that something you're thinking of?
Well, I've kind of done, I do that occasionally anyway. I mean, I do. I mean, I did some shows at the end of last year in the UK, some club shows, and yeah, we played the hits. But we played everything else as well. We played everything from the last 40 years, just bits and pieces, edited highlights or whatever. So I do that on anyway. But just a dedicated show to those specific albums, playing every track on the albums is something. It's different, and people seem to like it. I mean, I went to see. I mean, I do. I went to see Peter Gabriel do the So album again a couple of years ago, and that was amazing. So yeah, I get why people buy into this. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of, I mean, first of all, it's 4 years is an incredible achievement for any artist. Like you said, it kind of came up in your mind. I mean, how does it feel talking about that as a milestone? I mean, for any musician to reach that stage in the career is incredible, especially these days.
Yeah, no, it's Yeah, I'm really gratified that I can still put a few bums on seats to hear those tunes, and I don't think, although at the time when you're going through it, you kind of, and you're in the middle of this bubble where everybody's telling you that you're the best thing since sliced bread, and you'll think you're more famous than the Pope. You're kind of not, but you don't know that at the time, and you just assume that it's going to go on forever. And then you realize actually it's not, and then obviously it kind of, we've all been up and down and up and down, and I've been down, and it's and at those points in life, you stop taking it for granted and think, yeah, that's it was I just had a few good years, and then but and then it all picked up again, and here I am still, but by dint of those, the fact that people are still buying into it, it's just you just yeah, it's just extraordinary. And I can't honestly say I understand why, but I'm not looking that particular gift horse in the mouth.
Absolutely. I mean, looking back, I mean, you talked about those being your two biggest albums. Did your kind of ambitions change at that point? Did you, like you said, people kind of, I guess, big you up or tell you, like you said, I think you're bigger than the Pope. Did your ambitions change?
Yeah, my ambition changed to selling less albums. It's no, I just think I took a breather, because I thought this is just insane. I mean, I didn't re I, why I didn't protest in the first place, and I just didn't tell the record company to fuck off when they asked for a second album in 9 months. I don't really I know, but I do know that after promoting those two albums and sort of come the sort of back end of 1985, I was completely fried, and I wanted to take. And I wanted to produce my own album, and I wanted to take my time over it, and blah blah blah. So that's kind of what happened with the next album. It wasn't it, I didn't intend to be less popular, but that wasn't part of the plan.
What was the plan?
The plan was just that, just to kind of just to diffuse the whole kind of teeny bop fan thing a little bit, and just get on with trying to make an album that was a bit more grown up, and which was fine, and that, but that kind of predictably bit me in the arse a little bit, and which is fair enough. And yeah, and the fourth album was more of the same, and the record company kind of changed everyone. So I didn't know anybody that worked there by the time I came back from Los Angeles in the fourth album, and it was all a bit, well, who are you then?
Yeah.
So then I kind of decided to take a back seat and just write and produce for about 9 or 10 years.
Yeah. Do you regret that decision, or were you happy with the way that turned out?
No,
I don't
regret that at all. It was a good period. It was a good learning period for me. I learned a lot of other people about how they worked, how they wrote songs, and I had to relearn how to be a songwriter, really, because writing for other people and work and collaborating, that's an art in itself.
Yeah.
Ultimately, it turns out that I'm too much of a control freak to be
We
very good
we
at
all are.
it.
We all are.
So I ended up making my own records again, but that's by the by. That period was you know, is sometimes fruitful, sometimes not, ultimately quite frustrating, I think. But I don't regret making that decision, no, not at all.
Okay. I mean, just going back to the two albums, you talked about the kind of teeny bopper phase and thinking you should have told your record label to do one. I mean, but just in the whole touring and recording of those albums, what do you remember most about it? What were the highlights?
I seriously enjoyed the studio time and just working with the characters I was working with. I mean, working with Peter Collins, producer who sadly passed this year.
Yeah.
But also Julian Mendelssohn, the engineer, was such a character and an amazing engineer. Looking back at those recordings, you see the quality of the recording. When actually being a recording engineer was a proper art, and you had to get stuff down on tape.
Stuck into it, yeah.
Yeah, really, really knew what he was doing. Just the joy of building those records, really. That's the thing I remember most. Because the gig wise, I always felt kind of anxious and stressed and not, that really wasn't my element at the time. For some reason, I thought I had this, because you're in this, because you're own in your own little bubble, you kind of think that everything's revolves around you and everything you do is desperately important, you know. And then, and you sort of lose sight of the fact that it's pop music and it's a gig, you know, get over it. And now I've learned that over the years, and consequently, gigs are much more enjoyable, and I can actually spend time on stage being in the moment and enjoying it.
Well, what kind of prompted that change, or where do you feel it
just
changed?
getting older and just being able to step back from yourself a little bit, I think, because you literally are, people are telling you that you're the best thing since sliced bread, and there's a whole load of people whose livelihood is invested in what you do and all that, and you've got 40 or 50 people on tour with you, and it's all and the more people, and you start feeling responsible for everybody, and the more people are responsible for you, the more stressful it gets, and all that. And obviously, that isn't the case now. It's just kind of me and a bunch of idiots.
That's my life. Bus. That it's the best way to be. You know, we've talked about what you remember about recording and touring those albums, but you were at a point at that time when British pop music was at its height. I mean, what do you remember being part of that whole industry and that whole scene? I mean, well, a lot of people, we've spoken to other artists who said it was just stressful and tremendously hard work, and they kind of weren't prepared for the highs and lows. I mean, what do you remember about that whole industry and that period of time?
Yeah, it's quite, I wasn't prepared for the how your life becomes not your own anymore. Not that there's any kind of Machiavellian character taking it over or anything, or force taking it over. It's just the way it goes. It's just kind of when something like that kicks off, it has a momentum of its own that there's nothing you can do to. You either get off completely, you either jump off the train, or you keep hanging on for dear life. And I hung on for dear life for about 2 years, I'd say, because because you can't, other than other than booking studio time and being in that, they were the kind of, they were my holidays, the studio time, is you can relax, you can spend time getting things right, and you can take your time over stuff. But the rest of the time is, you have to, you know, if there's a TV show in Dortmund, yeah, on the 14th, you have to be in the TV show in Dortmund on the 14th. If you have to be on that plane at that time, you have to be in that rehearsal studio at that time, you have to be doing a radio interview, Radio One, that time. And you don't, you know, it just kind of, you are a kind of servant to the schedules.
Yeah, I was going to say, we interviewed Popstar, well, one of Popstar recently, said they, I mean, I know it's a slightly different situation, but they said they went straight from like school to go on Top of the Pops to go somewhere else, to go straight back to school, and there was no kind of breathing space with any of it.
It's probably even worse than if you're in a band, because it's the band is, it takes over, and it's like you might be a member of the band, but you just do as everybody else does, because you haven't got any free will in a band. I wouldn't think, that must be awful.
I mean, in terms of kind of the industry now, what advice would you give somebody that's been kind of molded into the limelight to be, say, I don't know, the next big thing? I don't know. Just, what advice would you give somebody?
It can only be sort of general advice, because it's a completely, totally different business.
Yeah.
You know, but it's probably even more so. I can't imagine being the victim of all the social media abuse and attention that some of these guys get. I've had a little bit of it, but to the extent that they're getting, it must be awful. And I just guess you have to separate the celebrity from the person, really. I mean, you just have to remember who you are and surround yourself with good people, you know, and just take good advice from good people, and that's the only general thing I can, you know, advise.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, looking back, I mean, you talked about the two albums being your kind of biggest albums, and you talked about obviously touring recently and fans coming out to the shows. Do you have any message for those fans, and do they still talk to you about those records?
I think the biggest message would be thank you, because you know, without them, it wouldn't be anything. And the fact that they're still coming out means I have the luxury of being able to pick and choose the shows I do and what I do, you know, and the records I make and everything. I've been able to have my own life because of those guys, you know, and that's been amazing. So yeah, and just thank you for sticking with me and just, you know, being patient when I'm making the new records and just being there for me when I come back out and get on stage, and there you are again. That's just I can't you know, tell you how grateful I am to those guys.
I mean, in terms of kind of going forward, Dan, what's kind of between now and the tour?
Between now and the tour, and it's not like, it's only a couple of months, so it's I'm starting to panic now, because I've been, because it's I've got still got a school age kid, so it's school holidays and we've been doing stuff, and it was, I haven't been in this back in my studio. I've started routining some of the songs, because we've got basically 2 days rehearsal, so I need to make sure that everybody knows what they're doing before we get to rehearsal, and they've sort of all prepped up, and we're just practicing and playing it together for those 2 days.
And on that note, we do like a just for fun question, which is a bit kind of off the wall, a bit different. Question for you: if as a punishment you were locked in a room 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, what would it be? Who or what would it be your biggest nightmare to be locked in with, and why?
Oh my God, that's a tricky one. I think it would be me with a television showing Downton Abbey on repeat, all episodes.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Because I loved the movie. There was a movie called Gosford Park, which is brilliant.
Right.
But the problem is my wife loves it. She absolutely loves Downton Abbey, and she watches all the repeats all of the time. Oh, and it's just, I can't even walk into a room when it's on anymore. It's just, it's got to that stage. So yeah, that would be my idea of purgatory.
I remember reading, I know it's slightly different, but it's a similar sort of style, but I remember being force-fed Pride and Prejudice at school.
Yeah.
Every minute of school. because of that. Because of that, it's the worst. Okay, brilliant. Okay, I mean, just to finish off, firstly, good luck with the tour. I mean, I'm hoping we can get to one of the shows and catch up and carry this on.
Yeah, cool.
Absolutely banned Downton Abbey, so there will be none of that.
Fantastic.
But if you've kind of seen it inside out, I may test you with some questions on your knowledge of Downton Abbey. So we'll see how we'll see how
Sadly, I might know some of the answers. That's the saddest thing. It's kind of you can't let just
we've
kind
done tests with other bands and things on different things, but now you've said that, I've kind of my mind's whirring already. So thanks for that. Just to finish, like I said, though, firstly, congratulations. I mean, 40 years as an artist is an incredible achievement. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
We've talked about kind of going up to October and what you've got planned and then the tour. Kind of what about the rest of 24 and beyond? I mean, what ambitions have you got left? And what is in
We've
the
got we're taking the 84 tour into Europe, so we're doing that to Christmas, and that spills into 2025 when we go to Poland. And then there'll be more festivals next year, I'm sure, and they'll and I've got a probably a, an up close and personal kind of solo tour at the back end of next year
okay.
with a book involved as well. So that's going to be interesting.
Yeah. What's the book? I mean, is it a kind of life story thing?
It's not actually a life story. I mean, there's quite a few people doing these tours. I think the guy started by making. Sorry, I'm just going to check the time because I don't know when the
That's okay.
next one is. I think we're all right. Can I just have a quick check?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, we're good. Yeah, he started off by as a book publisher making high-end coffee table books for cooks, celebrity chefs.
Oh, okay.
So then he thought, well, what if I do I branch out and do this for other people? And he started doing it for artists,
Right.
and then put tours together to promote the book. First they were speaking tours, then they would turn it to gigs, then they would turn it. It's a kind of, John Lydon's done it, Francis Rossi's done it,
Yeah.
Martin Fry's doing it this year, I think. Marty Pello's done it. You just do a bunch of gigs and talk about the book and talk about bits and pieces, but every show's different, every book's different as well. So it was basically up to me what I made the book about, and I didn't want to write a biography, so I just made a wrote a I thought I'd pick 20 songs and I'd write about those songs. And then
Okay.
I started the process and I thought, trouble is, if the 20 songs I pick are going to have to be the ones I play on the show,
Yeah.
and it might not necessarily be the ones that are the most interesting story. So I thought, oh, okay. So what about? Oh, I'll do all of them. So I just so it's every song from every album, every studio album,
Right.
up to date, really. So just me either writing about them or the con or what I was doing in context as part in that bit will be biographical, or just stupid random thoughts about, brought up by the subject matter of the song. And just, some it's hopefully some of it's quite humorous, quite funny. It's not meant to be taken seriously, but it might give you a little insight into the songs themselves, that's all. And I don't know how whether it's gonna be photographs, it's gonna be, I don't know, we haven't made the book yet, but I've written it, but
Perfect.
we shall see.